In the previous two videos, we discussed three of the five security classification categories, including held-to-maturity securities, trading securities, and available-for-sale securities. In this video, we will discuss the accounting related to securities when a company has either significant or controlling influence. First, let's discuss securities when a company has significant influence. Securities in this category must be long-term equity securities. So debt securities, or any short-term securities, will never fall into this category. Secondly, the securities usually must make up somewhere between 20 and 50% of the outstanding voting stock of a corporation. This is why these securities are classified as carrying significant influence, as having between 20 and 50% of the voting power carries considerable influence over decisions that a corporation makes. Finally, securities in this category are not reported at amortized cost or fair value like other securities that we have looked at, but rather are accounted for according to a method of reporting called the equity method, which we will discuss in more detail when we get to the journal entries. Now let's talk about securities when the investor has a controlling influence over the investee. Just like with securities carrying significant influence, securities with controlling influence must be long-term equity securities. The difference is that now, more than 50% of the voting stock, or common stock typically, of another corporation must be owned. With over 50% of the voting shares, the investor has complete control over all voting decisions, including election of the corporation's board of directors. When a corporation is in this situation, we call the controlling investor the parent and the investee the subsidiary. The parent and the subsidiary maintain separate accounting records and are still separate legal entities. The parent's investment in the subsidiary is reported in what are called consolidated financial statements, which are financial statements prepared as if the business were organized as one entity. The details of this procedure are discussed in more advanced accounting courses. Just to sum things up, here is a chart that shows the accounting method for equity investments based on a percentage ownership. Equity investments ranging from 0 to less than 20% ownership are reported at fair value. Investments with 20 to 50% ownership are reported according to the equity method. Investments with more than 50% ownership require consolidated financial statements to be prepared. Let's look at an example to show what the journal entries used under the equity method look like. So the problem says that Conservative D Corporation purchased 20% of the outstanding common stock of Ellison Enterprises on January 1st, 2020, by paying $2.5 million for 25,000 shares. Ellison Enterprises declared and paid a cash dividend of $1.50 per share on February 1st, 2020. Ellison Enterprises reported net income of $1 million for the year. The end of the year fair value of Ellison Enterprises stock is $120 per share. Now notice that 20% of the outstanding stock of Ellison Enterprises was purchased, which is right at the cutoff point between using the equity method and the fair value method. So what we're going to do is prepare the journal entries in both ways so that you can see the differences. Now the first journal entry that we want to prepare is that Conservative D Corp. purchased 20% of the outstanding common stock of Ellison Enterprises on January 1st, 2020 by paying $2.5 million for 25,000 shares. So the first journal entry is for the acquisition of stock, which is essentially the same for either the equity method or the fair value method. In either case, we are getting a long-term investment. So this is long-term investments, and that's going to be for $2.5 million. And then, of course, we're going to be paying cash, so we will credit cash also for $2.5 million. Now remember that one of the assumptions behind the equity method was that the shares had to be long-term investments or long-term equity shares. So that's how I knew this was going to be long-term investments here. Now for the fair value method, remember there were two different cases. It could either be available for sale or trading securities if you watched the previous video. But if we know they're long-term investments, then they're going to have to be available for sale securities because trading securities are short-term. So this is going to be long-term investments, AFS, for $2.5 million, and then also cash for $2.5 million. Next, Ellison Enterprises declared and paid a cash dividend of $1.50 per share on February 1st, 2020. So let's start with the fair value method, as it's relatively straightforward. We take the number of shares, which is 25,000, and multiply by the dividend per share, which is $1.50. And when we multiply those two numbers together, we get $37,500. So we debit our cash account for $37,500. Next, we have to credit dividend revenue, also for $37,500. For the equity method, we're still going to debit cash for $37,500. But classifying this as a dividend revenue, as we did with the fair value method, would not be quite correct, as we have such a high percentage ownership in the company. Using dividend revenue would be sort of like paying money to ourselves and classifying it as a revenue. Instead, we view this transaction as a conversion from long-term investments into cash. So we credit the long-term investments account, also for $37,500. Next, the end of the year fair value for Ellison Enterprises stock is $120 per share. So first, for the fair value method, we need to have a journal entry for the fair value adjustment. First, we find the total market value, which is $120 per share multiplied by the 25,000 shares which we own, which equals $3 million. And then we find the total cost, which, since this is the only investment we own, is just the $2.5 million from the very first journal entry that we did up here. The fair value minus the cost gives us $500,000, which is the desired debit balance for the fair value adjustment account. Now, assuming that this account currently has a zero balance, that means we need to debit the fair value adjustment AFS account for $500,000, and then we need to credit unrealized gain equity also for $500,000. Now, the reason we know it's an unrealized gain is because the value of the investments increased during the period. The fair value is $500,000 more than it was last period. If the fair value was less than it was in the previous period, we would have an unrealized loss. For the equity method, the fair value of the stock is completely irrelevant. There's no journal entry required for this information. So we are going to put no journal entry required. Next, Ellison Enterprises reported net income of $1 million for the year. Now, under the equity method, the investor owns a large portion of the stock in a corporation. So we also recognize a portion of the net income from that corporation as our own, proportional to the number of shares owned. So in this case, we take the percentage ownership in Ellison Enterprises, which is 20%, and multiply by the net income, which is $1 million, to get $200,000. This is the portion of the income from Ellison Enterprises that we need to report. So we are going to credit the account, which is called Earnings from Long-Term Investment, for $200,000. Now, at the same time, since Ellison Enterprises recorded net income, our claims on their assets as partial owners has actually increased, making our investment more valuable. So for that reason, we debit the long-term investments account, also for $200,000. Now, for the fair value method, there is no journal entry related to the net income for the corporations whose stock that you've invested in. So we're going to put no journal entry required. All right, we are finished with the journal entries. Now, the last thing I want to discuss is the balance of the long-term investments account and how it's different under the two different methods. For the fair value method, it's very straightforward. The only time that you'll change the long-term investments account is either when you have a purchase, which we had right here for $2.5 million, or you have a sale, which we didn't have in this case. Do remember, though, that on the balance sheet, you would also list that fair value adjustment account next to the long-term investments account. Now, it's a little bit more complicated when you're using the equity method. The long-term investments account is going to increase whenever there is a purchase of shares, which we had right here, or when the corporation that you've invested in has some net income. And it's going to decrease anytime there are dividends or if there was a sale of investments, which we didn't have in this case. You could also see a net loss instead of a net income, and that would decrease the investment account by crediting it instead of debiting it as we did with the net income. And as you can see, this leads to different amounts for the balances in the two different methods. For the fair value method, we ended with $2.5 million, And for the long-term investments for the equity method, there was $2,662,500. Now, one last thing I want to note is that you have to be a little bit careful if there is a sale of long-term investments when you're using the equity method. For example, if 2,500 shares were sold, which is 10% of the original 25,000 that were purchased, the long-term investments account should decrease by 10% of the balance, which would come out to, well, 10% of this number is going to be $266,250. The journal entry for the equity method is showing on the screen now, assuming that the shares were sold for $300,000. We debit cash for the $300,000 received, credit long-term investments for 10% of the balance, which is $266,250, and credit the gain on the sale of long-term investments for the difference, which is $33,750. We use a gain here as the investment was sold for more than the current balance in the investment account. The journal entry for the fair value method would be very similar, except for 10% of the outstanding investment would only be $250,000 this time, making the gain equal to $50,000. All right, that wraps up our journal entries comparing the equity method and the fair value method.